The Abdul Latif Jameel Poverty Action Lab. Translating research into action.
So this then led us to a different question and with a different group of voters, where we say, okay, now if these programs have this type of effect, is there, and more generally, if changes in nutrition and healthcare and overall in the risk factors matter, is there an optimal age for exposure? Is there, and this is related to very much to the, again to the nutrition and the medical literature, where there's a lot of emphasis in the first 1,000 days of life. And so a hypothesis, if I may say so, based mostly on in fact on anthropometric evidence, on evidence of height and weight, that the first 1,000 days of life might be crucial both for cognitive skill formation and for physical development. And so what we're thinking of here is saying, okay, what if, so if these programs have these impacts on cognitive development, maybe they also allow us to look at the timing, at the critical timing of intervention. So what we're going to do here is a slightly different exercise, because we went back in 2010 to a program that had started in 2002, so 10 years earlier. So this was a different part of Nicaragua, people who know Nicaragua, to a large part in Matagalpa, to a certain part also, again in Madrid, a different municipality. And so here, what's interesting and what allows us to look at this question of the critical the window is that there is a, again, this was randomized as the previous group. And so in 2000, there was a set of localities or villages that were selected to receive the program first, and in this case, they received it for 3 years. And then there was a second group of villages that randomly was selected to only get it 3 years later. After that, in 2005, also here the program stopped, and then nothing happened in terms of the program, the intervention. And then we went back in 2010 to collect data on these households, on these children, and to do a very similar battery of tests that we had done in the earlier intervention. So what we're going to do in particular is we focus on a cohort of children that, because of this timing of the intervention, was randomly exposed during the first 1,000 days of life. And when we say the first 1,000 days, we mean the 9 months in utero and the first 2 years of life. And so if we imagine a child that was basically conceived the day that, to kind of get the picture straight, a child that was conceived the day that the program starts, so that if that child happened to live in, or their household happened to live in a village that randomly received the program in the first period, that means that that child would have had the program during his whole period in utero, and then for the next 2 years of his life. And then the program would have stopped for him. Now, if the same child would have been born in the other villages, then this child would not have received the program the first 1,000 days of his life, and in fact, he would only have started receiving the program after he turned 2. And so, but then he would have received the same program. And so it is this timing and this randomized timing that allows us to look at the importance of having being exposed in utero in general during the first years of life. So this is going to be the differential between getting the program early versus getting a little bit later, still in early childhood, but after the age of 2. And so again, we're going to look at this 10 years later, so we're kind of looking at, again, the transfers by then have stopped for at least 5 years, do we see kind of long-term impacts and long-term differential impacts. I'm going to show, so we did this for both the boys and the girls, I'm going to focus in particular on the boys here, because the literature, the nutrition and medical literature suggests that they might be particularly vulnerable in time. So this is the timeline, right, so they have we have the intervention that starts, and if they were in the early treatment group, they got it from November 2000 to November 2003. If they were in the late treatment group, they got it from January 2003 to November 2005. And then the program stops. And then 5 years later, hence 10 years after the beginning of the program, we collected an annual. So what do we see? And so this is, I think, very interesting and somewhat unique evidence related to the 2000-day rule. So when we go back 10 years later, we see that those children, so the orange here are the significance results, the blue are non-significant. So what we see is that those children on cognition, 10 years later, those children that got it the first 1,000 days of life are doing about 0.15 of a standard deviation better on cognitive outcomes compared to those children that got the same program, but that happened to get it a little bit later in their life, after they turned two. And so this is a differential. So this suggests that the overall impact on cognition probably is larger. Remember, I showed you for the earlier intervention that for the whole group of 0 to 6, when we just have the kind of the short term or the medium term impact, we do see an impact even for the larger group. But what this evidence suggests and the timing suggests is that in particular it's those first 1,000 years of life where health and programs that change parental behavior, investment in nutrition and in health might be particularly effective. Now, interesting what we also see in that the blue non-significance result is that in fact this importance of the 1,000 days of life we do not see for anthropometrics, so for height and for weight. And in fact, for height and for weight we do have the short-term results. We know that those improved on the short term, very similar to the other intervention I've talked about. But then those effects, in fact, it's not that they disappeared, it's just that the people that the children that got it in the late treatment group, they got better nutrition after the term two, they actually still benefited from in terms of catching up for height and weight, but that same catch up didn't happen. So we find longer term a differential impact on cognition for boys from exposure in utero and in the first years of life. We do not find the same results for girls. And again, so we see the short term results in mathematics, but not the differential, suggesting that potentially the in utero period is much more critical for boys. So now, in the last few minutes, let me talk about where we took this next. So basically what we had so far is saying, okay, in these population and in four population in general, we see these large delays, but we also see that interventions can change and can help these children and country. Conditional cash transfer programs have many different facets, and so we have suggestive evidence that it is indeed the behavioral changes in different parts of the risk factors that would have changed that are kind of part of the explanation for why we see the changes. What we didn't know up to this point is that do we need the cash? Do we need to provide the cash and the information in a certain way about the importance of these investments and targeting it to the models, etc.? Or is it just a question about information? And so the reason why it could be a question of information is that if we look at the just purely descriptively at what parents in the settings know about practices of parenting practices, the levels tend to be very low. So in fact, for instance, there are very few of the young parents who talk to their young children very early on. And so kind of the knowledge about that potentially being beneficial for their language development wasn't, at least again, descriptively didn't seem to be there. So this then led us to say, okay, we have these results, we see that we can have changes in behavior, can we get changes in behavior by only providing information? And then related to that, can we look at this question of is it important to target the models for some of the parents? Because in a certain way, all the conditional cash transfer programs say, well, we're going to target the models because she might invest more in the children. But once we take away the cash, and in these settings, it is typically the fathers who have the cash info, maybe when we just provide information, we might also need to include the fathers. So to give you a better idea, what did we do then? We worked with a civil society organization in Nicaragua to train a number of educators, facilitators to do home visits to a poor rural population again, and to work with the father or the mother or both to show them how to stimulate this child, how to indicate different early childhood practices. So this evidence is more preliminary, but we do find relatively small with significant improvements in early childhood indicators from this relatively low intensity intervention, in the sense of the visits were not very regular and not very structured, in fact, either, in contrast, for instance, to some of the work that Pellegrin Matraga has been doing in Jamaica, more recently in Colombia, and in Peru, where the intensity aggregation was larger. And so, but what this does suggest is that both from our evidence and from evidence from these other countries is that these type of interventions can change parental practices and attitudes, despite or maybe because of kind of strong social norms, low levels of education, low levels of resources. What we also find, and that is, I guess, unique for this particular intervention, because as far as we know, nobody else has been targeting, has been trying experimenting with targeting the fathers versus the mothers. So when we target the fathers, we see bigger impacts, and we see that in particular for the boys. And so this is part of what we're still working on, but certainly suggestive of potential impacts. So overall, just to summarize and then to open it up for questions, I think in terms of policy implications, the large delays we see and the potential for different types of interventions to change cognitive outcomes of children and to change them in a way that even 10 years later we still see is kind of suggestive of this being an important area for policy attention. The, as I said, kind of the fact that we see longer term results that I think make that case much stronger, that is kind of theoretically one of the reasons why people want to invest in early childhood development. I think it's kind of interesting to have this type of evidence from a setting where the long-term evidence wasn't there. It is also interesting to see this kind of long-term evidence for CCT programs in general, not even just thinking of early childhood, because of course, as I said, this is one of the original reasons for CCT programs is to invest in the capital of the next generation. We know relatively little of the long-term, and so here, at least 10 years later, we see that those children have higher cognitive impacts. The other implication is that what we see is that different interventions that facilitated investment and that focus on parents, their behavior, and reduction of risk factors in early childhood can play a role. So, at least to a certain extent, information and parental behavioral change is likely to be key for early childhood outcomes. So, as I said, before opening it up, what I talked about is based on collaborative efforts with a number of authors, in particular Tanya Baron and Joe Maluccio, from when I talked about the 10-year evaluation, Norbert Chardy and Rinos Vakis, when I talked about the first intervention, the same co-authors also with Patrick Primo when I talked about the parenting intervention, and the evidence for the rest of Latin America is a whole series of authors, and work with the government of Nicaragua, in particular with both the CCTs and with civil society. So let me finish there and open it up to questions. And then I think I'm going to open it up to the implications slide.